Because they said they're special. Well, actually. Well, that's certainly what Israel says. But, you know, again, you know, cynics will say, well, a lot of people say they're special. A lot of people say they're chosen by God to be special. What makes Israel such a big deal?
Because
we're reading it in the book.
Yeah, we're reading the, what's supposed to be the main book of their history, the Bible.
That's right. It's there in the Bible. And we might ask for a moment, well, there's really two threads that come along. But it is a phenomenal thing to consider that here we are in Sacramento, 2,700, 2,600 years after the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, talking about, you know, most of us with no genetic or cultural connection to the Hebrews, saying basically that they're right. Well, if we look back, if we kind of work our way back through history, actually, it's going to come through Jesus. And Jesus said that they were right. And Jesus rose from the dead. And, you know, even with Jesus, a few hundred years before the Constantine and the Roman Empire, people, I read the very interesting observation when I was preparing a different sermon. The guy made the observation that between Jesus and Constantine, that about 300 years, there's a ton of Roman pagan literature. You've got brilliant, great pagans writing, and in all of that literature that we have, there are 6 or 7 references to Christianity. That's all, 6 or 7. And when Constantine comes on board and converts, and suddenly Christianity is a really big deal. And because of Constantine and Christianity becoming a big deal in the Roman Empire, the empire is converted, and then by the Middle Ages, Christianity starts its progress in evangelizing the people, the pagan tribes of Europe, and another 1,000 years later, you get into the age of discovery, the colonial period, Christianity will go out into all the world, and you get to the 21st century, Christianity is now becoming dominant in places like Asia and Africa where it wasn't dominant before. And so you follow this entire path back, and why on earth do we believe that the Jews are special? It's because Christ believed the Jews were special, and Christ rose from the dead, which starts Christianity, and all the way through. That's the one track. The other track is that those darn stubborn Jews are just so darn stubborn. And you know, we don't talk today about the Babylonians in our midst who are still worshiping Marduk and still elevating the stories of Marduk in their book. But Jews all over the world continue to practice Judaism. And actually, this is the real form happens with Christ, because out of this period and out of the destruction of the temple in 70 AD, two separate groups, really what was kind of one group, becomes two separate groups, and it becomes the Christian, and then it becomes Rabbinic Judaism. And Rabbinic Judaism has been what has continued on through the centuries too. So it's an amazing, amazing thing that here we are, most of us, I mean, I've got some Jewish blood in me, I don't know about the rest of you, but most of us without any genetic link to the Hebrews, look at this book, look at this Bible and say, this is the Word of God. Wow. The Babylonians thought their god Marduk was the king god. The Babylonians conquered the Jews. The Jews continued to persist believing that their God was king. In a sense, that's what the book of Daniel is about. That these defeated people who would become insignificant people in the eyes of the important people of the world continued to insist that even through the pagan empires, their God reigned. And they did it so stubbornly, and they did it with so much determination that they didn't go away. And finally, when you come to Christ, the branch, the tree forks again, and this starts this entire amazingly odd story where this tiny group of people, I mean, think about how many apostles did Jesus have? How many after Jesus' ascension gather in this upper room in Jerusalem? How many believers were there who were kind of clinging to him at that point in Jerusalem? Well, 11 and then 12, but there's a little bigger group, 70, 120, so, you know, but we're talking about a very small group of people. And then the day of Pentecost comes, and what does the book of Acts say happens on the day of Pentecost? Thousands are added to their number. And this keeps going. But the world is a big place. So even as Christianity grows and adds people on through this period between Christ and Constantine, and as I mentioned before, 7 or 8 references to Christianity among the prominent pagan writers for the next 300 years until Constantine completely changes the story. And then on from there into the rest of the world. It's an astounding thing, but here we are. And we often don't have any perspective of what a strange thing this is. The Bible itself, the most, I mean, they long ago stopped putting it on a bestseller list because there's no point to having it on the bestseller list because it was always number one. The book is printed more than any other book in all of human history. It is the first book printed in the West in human history with movable type. It is translated into more languages than any other book in human history. It is found everywhere more than any other book in human history. This is an exceedingly strange thing from a group of people that should have been clearly forgotten. Do any of you know who the Parthians are or the Scythians? I mean, these people are gone. The Philistines, the Edomites, the Moabites, they're gone. And here we are talking about these people. And the book of Daniel has everything to do about that. So will this dogged determination by this group of people to actually believe that the God of the universe has chosen them for a special purpose and is going to do a work through them that will change the world? Well, on one hand, you cannot argue that it hasn't happened, because it in fact has happened. This group of people has changed the world, and they're still changing the world. There's no way to not notice this objectively if you look at human civilization. It is just a fact. And again, Daniel has everything to do about it. So a little bit of history towards the end. I started on this a little bit last time. We talked about, so Israel leaves Egypt, muddles around in the promised land, beleaguered by the Midianites, by the Philistines, by the Ammonites, and you find all that story in the book of Samuel. And then they want a king like everyone else, so Saul is raised up, but Saul doesn't really answer the question. And then, of course, after Saul, who arises and things take a new turn? King David. David arises, and David finally, under David, Israel becomes its own minor empire. Egypt isn't doing anything. The Mesopotamian kingdoms aren't doing anything. And then Solomon rises after David, and Solomon's, the empire kind of hits its peak, the empire of Israel. And then after Solomon, Solomon dies, and Solomon's son Rehoboam gets some bad advice from his advisors and says, basically, we're going to double down on taxes, and the 10 northern tribes rebel. And then we enter into this period of the divided kingdom where there's Judah and Israel, and often they're rivals competing against one another. And then the Assyrian Empire develops, and if you look on your map, if you see Nineveh, that's the capital of the Assyrian Empire. And you might remember the city of Nineveh from the book of Jonah. And again, this is just another illustration of the same strange point. If I were to say Nineveh to most people today who have any kind of background, they say, oh yeah, Nineveh and Jonah. But in the ancient world, Nineveh was a big deal because it was the capital of Assyria, the capital of a major empire. And Jonah was a nobody. But today we only remember Nineveh because of Jonah. And how does Nineveh come up in the book of Jonah? Okay, God sends word to Jonah. Jonah is from the northern kingdom of the 10 tribes of Israel, the northern kingdom. And the word goes to Jonah that 40 days and Nineveh will be overturned. And God says to Jonah, Jonah, go to Nineveh and announce to them that 40 days and you'll be overturned. So what does Jonah do? And if you look on the map, you can see Nineveh's over here. Jonah's down in this area north of Jerusalem, in the kingdom of Israel. And he takes a boat and he goes this way in the Mediterranean. And you can see that even, you know the story, he gets vomited up on the shore. He gets vomited up on the shore, and it's like, he's still got to take the whole trip to Nineveh. Because Nineveh is exactly the other way. And of course, he doesn't want to go to Nineveh. Why? Because he doesn't want to see Nineveh get toasted?
No, he doesn't want them to be converted.
That's right. He doesn't want them, he doesn't want God to rescue them. He doesn't want God to bless them. And so you have that whole story in the book of Jonah. But Nineveh is the capital of Assyria, this great empire, a brutal empire, very effective in conquering kingdoms. And the Assyrians take out the northern kingdom and threaten the southern kingdom. But these, let's talk a little bit about how politics worked in these kingdoms. True or false, these kingdoms were democracies. How did these kingdoms select their leaders, usually?
War,
that's right. You either inherit the throne or you kill the predecessor, usually with a military coup. And so what would often happen in these kingdoms is when they had a really shrewd, dominant leader, the kingdom would arise, and when that leader would die, there'd be a power struggle, and the kingdom would wobble. Well, after Assyria gobbles up the northern kingdom in Israel, the kingdom started to wobble. And what happened in this area, you see Judah, and you see Damascus and Tyre, and the old Israel is between Damascus and Tyre and Jerusalem, and that area there. When Assyria started to wobble, the other players, imperial players in the region, saw their opportunity. Now remember, Egypt down here is always a player. And so when Assyria starts to wobble, Egypt sees an opportunity. Now, if you're one of these tiny little kingdoms in the middle here, you become an opportunist too. And when you see a power rising, you have a decision to make. Either go with the rising power, or try and go it alone, or try and band together with some other small kingdoms to resist them, and or go with a rival power. So what you'll find if you read the prophets is that whenever someone gets wobbly, like when Assyria starts getting wobbly, Judah starts thinking about its future and says, now what should we do? Should we suck up to Assyria? But if Assyria is getting wobbly, should we rebel and try and go it on our own? Or should we send nice messages to Egypt and maybe back them? Hopefully we can get a better deal with Egypt than we've gotten with Assyria. And so these tiny kingdoms are always in this position of trying to figure out, pick who the winner is going to be, or try and go it alone, or try and, you know, gather a group of empires together. So Nineveh, Assyria gets wobbly. And when Assyria gets wobbly, if you look further down the Euphrates River there, you'll see Babylon. Assyria got wobbly, and Babylon started to assert itself. And what these kingdoms would do is they would look for partners. So Assyria got wobbly, Babylon started to assert itself, and you see on top the Median Empire, there's another group of people. So these two forces start to say, let's work together and throw off the bonds of tyranny from Assyria, and maybe we could be top dog, all right? So now when you think about your Old Testament stories that you learned in Sunday school, you might have heard of good King Josiah. What do we know of good King Josiah?
He was a young king.
And whereas some of those before him were cozying up to these empires. Now, if you cozied up to these empires, one of the things that you did was you start to align yourself religiously with them, because politics and religion were not separated. If you were going to become a vassal of the king of Assyria, guess what god you start offering sacrifices to? The gods of the Assyrians. So King Josiah, they're cleaning out the temple, and what do they discover in the temple? The book of the law. And King Josiah reads the book of the law, and what does he discover?
They haven't been keeping it!
And so he starts keeping it. And so the Old Testament talks about King Josiah in very wonderful terms, because here is a king that starts keeping the law. And again, we talk about this long thread of Israel's story. Israel often forgets herself and loses the law and loses her way with God. And under good King Josiah, Israel finds herself, and Josiah reforms his kingdom and begins putting back into place the sacrifices to the Lord and obedience to the Lord. And so there's a reform effort that goes. And again, if you read the prophets of the Old Testament story, you see this all the time, that Israel forgets itself and then someone arises and there's a reform movement. Well, this reform movement, go ahead, Marty.
Was he from the southern kingdom?
Yes, King of Judah. Okay. The northern kingdom is by this time destroyed. And Assyria has peopled it with other people from other conquered parts of its empire. And that kingdom will never again kind of take shape again as a Hebrew kingdom. Well, good King Josiah's reform happens at a time again when all these major empires are a little wobbly. And not one of them is kind of dominating. And so, you know, there's a space there for reform. And this is what King Josiah is doing. But now, Assyria is a little wobbly, and Babylon is on the rise, and they've partnered with the Median Empire, and Assyria is under a lot of pressure from them, which means that this whole region in here is now kind of free to go their own way. Josiah goes his own way. Now Egypt decides to get involved. Well, what does Egypt want? Well, Egypt wants what everybody else wants. Control, power, money, supremacy, hegemony. And so while Assyria's wobbly, while Babylon is rising, while the Medes have sided with the Babylonians, the Egyptians look around and say, hey, we're no longer afraid of Assyria because they're kind of wobbly, but we are afraid of, guess who they're afraid of now? Babylon. And so they decided that we're going to take control of this part here in the middle, reassert our ancient claims on Judah and Israel and Syria and all of these lands in here. And we're going to march our army up and we're going to bolster the Assyrians against the Babylonians. Well, good King Josiah hears this and says, I don't want the Assyrians reasserting themselves. So as Egypt is marching its army up north, Josiah decides to take the army of Judah and try to intercept the army of Egypt. And they fight a great battle in an area, I'm about to say its name, and you're going to recognize its name because of associations with other things. They fight a battle on the plains of Megiddo. Now, when I say Megiddo, I might say another word that's associated with it, Armageddon. What am I talking about?
End times.
Armageddon, end times. Well, Josiah takes his army up and challenges the king of Egypt on the plains of Megiddo. Josiah loses the battle and loses his life. Okay. Now what's going to play out in Judean politics? The king is dead. What happens next?
Either his sons or somebody else.
Okay, his sons. So his, everybody kind of knows his oldest son is a drip. And the second son is a good guy. So in hearing that Josiah is dead, they make the second son king. What do you think Egypt's going to do since Josiah marched his army out and fought against them to try and stop them? What do you think Egypt's going to do now? That's right. So Josiah fails to stop Egypt heading north. Egypt goes and meets the army of Babylon. There's a name right in the middle of here. Carchemish, Carchemish. And the army of Egypt that killed Josiah meets the army of Babylon and the Medes at Carchemish, and the Egyptian army is defeated. Now, what's that going to mean for the struggle for the northern part here? That's right. Now Babylon is going to be on the rise because Babylon destroyed or at least defeated the army of Egypt. But now the army of Egypt is going to head back to Egypt. But on their way back, they've got some unfinished business to attend to. And guess where they're going to stop? Jerusalem. And they stop in Jerusalem, and guess who they're going to take with them to remind Jerusalem about who's in charge?
Step out of the temple.
They're going to ask for tribute.
And the king.
And they're going to take the king. Josiah's good son. They're going to take him in bonds, and they're going to take him to Egypt, never to be heard from again. And Egypt then decides who's going to be king of Judah, king of Jerusalem, And Judah will then be a vassal of Egypt. And so Egypt installs Josiah's worthless son as king. And Josiah's worthless son becomes a really lousy king, just as everyone knew. And the army goes back to Egypt, and everything kind of stays a muddle. Now, this worthless son of Josiah, once the Egyptians leave, will get ideas. Because he's ambitious, but he's not very smart, and he's not very good. So he'll get ideas, so once the Babylonians leave and are gone for a little while, he starts to decide, you know what? Shucks. I don't want to keep sending money to Egypt. Let's just keep the money. Well, if you decide you're going to oppose these empires, stuff is going to happen. Well, because Egypt lost and Babylon is ascending, Babylon continues to come down and comes down this same path and will knock on Jerusalem's door themselves. And in fact, that's what happens in 605 when Nebuchadnezzar comes down. Actually, we don't have any evidence that Nebuchadnezzar himself came down, probably sent a general to Jerusalem and defeated the armies of Judah and took from Jerusalem, again, if you look at the beginning of the book of Daniel, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, that's one of Josiah's worthless sons, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. Now, what does verse 2 say? The Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles of the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasury house of his God. What's happening there, and what's interesting about how the book of Daniel tells it?
The Lord decided this. And it says the same thing in 2 Kings 24. Lord sent Babylon.
That's right. Now, what is strange about this?
He allows his people to be subjugated.
Yes. He allows his people to be subjugated. And now, let's not make this thing look pretty, shall we? The armies of Babylon besiege Jerusalem. Well, what's Jerusalem supposed to be? God's holy city. And the temple is God's embassy, God's place on earth. Isn't it God's job to defend Jerusalem? And here it says God gives them up to Babylon.
In Kings it says because of the sins of Manasseh.
Okay.
And all he had done, including the shedding of innocent blood. For he had filled Jerusalem with innocent blood, and the Lord was not willing to forgive.
That's right. So in other words, the story says Israel had this coming. And God turns his own people over. And now what's the significance of they take articles of the temple of God? Now, if you remember back to going through Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, you have things that are common and things that are holy and things that are unclean, right? What are the articles of the temple? The holy things of Israel are taken where and for what?
As loot.
As loot.
But I mean, that makes them very unimportant.
I mean, the treasure house of Babylon's God.
Now, what's the significance about taking, now surely they're gold, so on one hand they're precious, gold and silver, but the Babylonians understand exactly the meaning of all this. optics count. Why, when the U.S. does something in the Middle East, crowds in, well, just think about the storming of the U.S. Embassy in 75. You take a U.S. flag in Tehran, and what do you do with it?
Burn it in the street.
Burn it in the street. You take it, you make a dummy of the U.S. president, and you
hang him.
Burn it. When in the 2003 Iraq war, you had all these statues of Saddam Hussein. The U.S. troops come in, I mean, there's statues and stuff all over the place, and like there's this one very significant scene where they pull down this huge statue, and it crashes, and you find the Iraqis taking off their shoes and banging the shoes on the statues. Remember? Why did they bang their shoes on the statues? Well, when I was at Calvin College, a couple of guys across the hall, Imran and Ajay, they both went to school in Hillcrest, Nigeria, but one was from India and he was a Hindu, and the other one was from Pakistan and he was a Muslim. And I remember Imran was an observant Muslim, and I remember, you know, if I'm sitting there studying and I finish with a book, I'll set it down on the floor next to me. You can't put a book on the floor. He says, why can't I put a book on the floor? Symbol of disrespect. You ought to be treating books with respect. Now, I'm a secular Westerner. I put a book on the floor because it's convenient to me. Well, the reason they took off their shoes and banged the bottom of their shoes on the statue of Saddam Hussein was because the bottom of your shoe is unclean. And it's a symbol of that, where it says disrespect. This is how you insult someone. Well, you take the holy items out of the temple of the Lord and you bring them to Babylon and you put them into the storehouse of the temple of their God. What are you saying?
Their God is more powerful.
Their God is more powerful. The Lord has been, Yahweh has been discredited. Yahweh has been demonstrated to be less powerful than the gods of Babylon. And this has been demonstrated by the triumph of the kings of Babylon over Israel and the gods of their people. Everybody gets the message in the ancient world. And this is happening.
Could that be an anthem about the shoes on the floor? Because I'm in part of Latin, there's nothing goes on the floor.
Right.
And when I go to Villa, they take the bread and put it on the floor. And sometimes I don't read bread anymore, so I think now the kids are touching the bread. Even though it's in a packet, the kids are touching the fast, they go into the refrigerator, and that's it. Sometimes I even
care
about it.
Why do you think
bread on the floor?
That's right. Well, and that, you know, when I worked in the Dominican Republic, most of the houses, most of the people I worked with, they had dirt floors or cement floors. You had pigs and chickens running in and out. You know, and yeah, you go to a farm. You don't want to, you know what's on the ground in the farm? You don't put stuff you like down there. Now here we live in urban America, in these, we look on the floor and we think, well,
not very.
That's right. And then we have the 5-second rule. What's the 5-second rule?
Pick it up right away, you can eat it.
That's right. And they say, no, the 5-second rule isn't really true. If something falls on the floor, if you go to a restaurant and your fork falls on the floor, they'll give you a clean fork. Because everybody understands that our shoes track around a lot of germs and dirt. And so you're right. They probably should put the bread on the floor, but they would say the bread is in a plastic bag. So you are probably going to outlive us all because you're following what actually makes a lot of sense. which is that there's germs on the floor.
However, our bodies can read it.
Yeah, you can have that too. And that was in the paper lately.
It should be better to be exposed to some of that. Yeah.
Let your children be exposed to more germs. They live at least. In America, well, I mean, the point is some parents keep their children too clean.
Well, and what's funny is that my wife has taught in two public schools in Sacramento. She's taught in Fruit Ridge Elementary, which is a school in Oak Park, which had a lot of children from immigrant households, households of neglect, you know. So these kids were from rough houses. And you know what? Never had an allergy. Now she teaches at Alice Birney here, which is a school that everybody wants to get into because it has all the high test scores. She's got the most outrageous allergies in her class. No nuts, no wheat, no eggs, no milk, no almost anything. These kids almost can't eat anything. All grown up in all these clean houses. That's why they say, when your kid is young, get him a pet.
Let him eat dirt.
Yeah, let him eat dirt. Ever watch a dog? You think a dog is clean? Dog ain't clean. Anyway, so, but the point here is that everybody in the ancient world understands what's going on here. The God of Israel is letting himself be conquered by the other gods. See, now when I say it that way, we begin already to get hints of Christ. Why do I say that?
Christ let himself be crucified.
Christ let himself be crucified by whom?
The Romans.
The Romans. You see, Nebuchadnezzar, in the minds of Israel, Nebuchadnezzar is just one of the empires of the world who will subjugate Israel. Assyria takes out the northern kingdom. Babylon takes out the southern kingdom. Babylon gets replaced by the Medes and Persians. So again, once Babylon comes to supremacy, and we'll hear about this in the book of Daniel, the Median Empire, you see Elam here and Susa, they'll ally then with Babylon's rivals and take out Babylon. And the Persian Empire will come, and Persia again will conquer all of this. And then after Persia, who then is going to arise? The Greeks. And they're going to conquer the Persian Empire and go down. And after the Greeks, the Greek Empire, who then is going to arise? The Romans. And so this is why the book of Daniel feels very up to date in the time of Christ. And that, now remember, again, at the point I made last time, this is going on for 600 years. This is a long time. This ancient kingdom of David around 1000 BC, that's even 400 years old by the time you get to the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. Again, 400 years. The United States has had its independence how long? 1776, there's the bicentennial that we remember. So, not very long. So, then the king ordered Ashpenaz, chief of his court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility. So when Babylon went down to Jerusalem, besieged it, conquered it, took Jehoiakim, also took with him some of the young men. Why would he take young men to Babylon? What does he want from them? Wants to what?
Groom them.
Wants to groom them. Groom them for what?
I mean, for whatever he wants.
For whatever he wants.
Well, assimilate them.
He's going to assimilate. Now, okay, so Babylon is in charge now of Judah. Well, what are some of the immediate needs that if you're, okay, so U.S. goes and invades Iraq. What are some of the first things that U.S. soldiers need as they're, after they invade Iraq, they conquer, they overthrow Saddam Hussein, and then they get into the business of occupying. Now, occupying is, in some ways, as the U.S. discovered in Iraq, more difficult than conquering. Why? They can't communicate with the people. They don't know their language. They don't know their culture. So right away, what do the occupiers need in order to have an effective occupation?
Whisperers.
You need intermediaries. You need people that understand both Babylon and Judah. Well, how do you get these people? Well, you could go down and start paying people. That's what the U.S. basically did. You hire interpreters. Well, that can be a little ticklish sometimes because you're paying people, but are they, can you really trust them? So Babylon says, we're going to take the brightest and the best and we're going to take them to Babylon and we're not going to put them in a dungeon and torture them. Why? We want these people to come to Babylon and say, I love Babylon. Babylon knows how to run a country. Babylon knows how to have a city. Now think about it today. People, let's say you grew up in a little town in the Dominican Republic, and you get a scholarship to Stanford. And you move to Northern California, where the lights stay on all the time. And the internet or the supermarkets are stocked with food, and all of the meat in the supermarket here, the power never goes out, so the meat doesn't smell funny. And in fact, when the meat gets a few days old, what do they do with it here? They take it out. They don't sell it anymore. And so when you buy meat from the supermarket, you know what? You can trust it. And when you go to the doctor treats you well. And you can have a car. And, well, you're a student at Stanford, so you're hearing lectures from the best people in the world. How do you feel about Stanford, and how do you feel about your little town in the Dominican Republic?
Mixed emotions.
Well, you love where you came from. They're your people, blah, blah, blah. But
the good life.
The good life is in San Jose, California, where you go into the supermarket and you can have anything you want, as long as you can pay for it. Where the meat, when you take the meat, it's fresh. And so when you go down to the Dominican Republic, you know what you tell your people? They really know how to run things in the United States. Their lights stay on. The food in the supermarket is good. I don't get stopped by the cops just when I go down the street because the cops are looking to get a little bribe out of me for just going down the highway. Here in the United States, things work as they should. This is the goal of taking the brightest and the best of Judah into Babylon to make them loyal to Babylon so that these people can now administer the occupation over Judah.
Wasn't it also because they left the weak and the old there so there was less chance they rebel?
Well, and later
the younger and the brightest out.
Right. Once the conquest in 586. See, the perpetual problem of these nations conquering Judah is that These Jews just don't assimilate. They just don't. Doggone it, they're so darn stubborn. And so you have to keep conquering Judah. Because they just don't get along. But the idea behind, the bigger exile happens in 586 BC. But at this point, the idea of Babylon is we want to train these young men. and we want to indoctrinate them in our way of life so that when they go back to Judah, they will say, we're going to show you how things should be run. So actually, when you go to the Dominican Republic and you find people who have been educated in the States, guess what kinds of things they usually do when they gain power in their little banana republic? They say, we're going to have things run here like they run in the United States, like they taught me in the University of Miami or University of New York or Stanford University. And this is, in effect, how the United States today, you go to almost any little third world country, you will find the elites of the country were educated at American universities, and part of what they want to do is have these countries run to the degree that they can, like they learned in the United States. Okay? This is what's going on in Babylon. So, the court ordered Ashpenaz, the chief of his court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility. Young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. They want the brightest and the best that Judah has to offer. Good-looking young men. Now, a little tantalizer, there's a real debate about what Babylon then does when Babylon puts these young men into the king's service. Do you ever hear about Daniel's wife? Daniel's wife? Do you ever see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego starting a family?
Did they make them eunuchs?
Did they make them eunuchs? Probably. We don't know. But probably. Why would the king of Babylon make these young men eunuchs?
Wouldn't be distracted by anything.
That's right. In the ancient world, you often made your slaves that you wanted for administration and trust, eunuchs, because their interests wouldn't be divided between service to you and family. Now think about this. Why in the reforms, medieval reforms in the Roman Catholic Church, did they mandate celibacy for priests?
So they would be loyal to God only and not be distracted.
Well, and actually in the Middle Ages, the issue of many priests were not allowed to marry, but many actually had concubines. They had girlfriends. And this was always an issue in the medieval church.
Probably the letter of the law.
That's right. And the church in many ways kind of looked the other way. But that's indicative of the purpose behind the mandate. They wanted the priests to be loyal to the church and not have a family. Now, if the priest, you know, had a little something on the side, that's okay. Everyone understood a concubine does not make a claim. Now, this becomes a big issue in the Protestant Reformation. Protestant Reformation basically looks at that mandate of priestly celibacy and says, it's failed. Ministers should marry. And gets into a lot of other things. But I mean, these conversations and these connections carry on through cultures. And so here, Nebuchadnezzar wants, you know, fine young men, which he's about to turn into eunuchs. Now, this gets into a bit of a cultural crisis because now when it says without any defect, and we hear this in an Old Testament context, guess who couldn't enter into priestly service in the Old Testament temple to the Lord?
Eunuch.
Eunuch. Because you can't be, you can't have anything, you can't have anything cut off.
Except you can be circumcised.
Except you can be, that's the one thing. You had to be circumcised. That had to be cut off, nothing else. And so when you get to the story of the Ethiopian eunuch in the book of Acts, he was a Jewish convert, traveled all the way to Jerusalem, but couldn't worship with the Jewish men because he was a eunuch. He was altered. So, you know, all this cultural stuff going on beneath the surface. So, you take these wonderful young men. He was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. They were to be in service of the king of Babylon, in the service of his empire, and the king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. Now, from the king's table basically means that the king is providing this to them. They will get the best that Babylon has to offer. And again, the reason for this: the king wants to convert these young men to the Babylonian way, to help these young men see that life as it should be really happens in Babylon, not in Jerusalem. Oh, but what's implicit in the law that the Lord, the Creator God, gives Israel?
You shall
worship no other gods before me. Life as it should be is lived in the law. So right away, the conflict is set. Who really defines life as it should be? Is it the Babylonian way? Or is it the way of the law, of the Lord? And as we get into it, the first conflict is going to be over food. Who tells us? Should you put the loaf of bread on the ground or not? The way of, should you take your book and put it on the ground? The way of Imran says, you should show respect to books. You would never put a book on the ground. You want to offend an observant Muslim? Take the Quran and put it on the ground. Take the Quran and let it touch your shoe. That's highly offensive.
Yeah, when you're on top of the Quran, you can't put another book on top of the Quran.
That's right. You don't put another book on top of the Quran. You show your respect and your esteem in all of these ways. You think we as Americans have ways, cultural ways, that we show respect for things? All the time. The difficulty about one's culture is it's always harder to see your own culture than the culture of someone else. Because your own culture, you say, well, this is just how it's done. That's why often they say, well, white people think they have no culture. Well, that's because if you're living in a majority context, well, everyone just agrees this. No, everyone doesn't just agree this. Talk to Maury about it. Maury's visited a number of Islamic countries. Maury's visited Iran. he can give you a lot of interesting stories about culture and propriety and all of these things. But right here in the book of Daniel, the battle is about to be joined. Is the Babylonian way of life best? Or is the Lord's way of life best? And right away, it's going to come down to first stop in the culture battle is eating. So we'll get into that next week. What's that? Well, you know, so last week, Sunday evening, I preached in our church plant in Davis that worships in the evening. They rent a Jewish, not very observant Jewish synagogue, but a Jewish synagogue. They rent their worship space. The Jews actually bought it from a church. It used to be a church. Now it's a synagogue. Now this church rents from the synagogue, but they're going to have a potluck this week. Guess what? They have to promise the Jews they can't bring into the potluck meat. No meat at all. No meat at all. And, well, read the book of Daniel. What do Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego only eat?
Vegetables.
Let's pray. Lord, you
are the God of heaven and earth. And all these cultural conversations are complicated. But the drama that's about to unfold in the book of Daniel is a drama about what culture is true, what way of life is best. Does the Lord really govern the whole world? Or is the way of whatever empire is on top in charge? We believe, Lord, that you are the God over all the earth, and we believe that you revealed yourself in Jesus Christ. And Lord, as this cultural conversation gets going through Daniel and into the culture war of the first century in Judea, and then through the gospel going out into the Roman Empire, and then into medieval Europe, and then into the colonial period, and now in the 21st century, the conversations continue. And we believe, Lord, that your gospel continues to march, and that your kingdom is still doing its work in the world, and we are a part of it. Help us, Lord, to believe. Help us, Lord, to trust. Help us, Lord, as we go through the book of Daniel, to understand the nuances of all of these conversations. And give us your spirit and give us your light. We ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.